week on Vaticano, join us in celebrating the 350-year anniversary jubilee of the Marian Fathers of the Immaculate Conception. Learn about the philosophical implications of artificial intelligence and what ChatGPT means for the Church. And travel to Quito, Ecuador, as we begin our series on The Center, a family of families, where people break free of the circle of poverty and violence. Vaticano starts now. The Jerome Lejeune International Chair of Bioethics organized an event at the Vatican entitled The Audacity of an Encyclical on Sexuality and Procreation to discuss Paul VI's encyclical, Humanae Vitae, published in July of 1968. The conference was spread over 2 days, and numerous experts took turns to talk about the encyclical from different points of view. Also present on the first day was Cardinal Luis Francisco Ladaria Ferrer, Prefect of the Dicastery for the Doctrine of the Faith, who described the document as a text capable of uniting freedom with nature.
So the first recommendation which we make is to reread the encyclical with an open mind. Try to understand its meaning. It's true that if an encyclical in those days was already prophetic, imagine today, 55 years later, where the issues have still manifested themselves. It was prophetic because really the contraceptive abortifacient mentality of promoting promiscuity has increased in these decades. So I think at this time it is more necessary than then to read it again.
Cardinal Matteo Zuppi, president of the Italian Episcopal Conference, stressed that Humanae Vitae is still an invitation to question ourselves seriously about the problems posed by the distance between the indication of the Church's magisterium regarding the generation of life and the daily experience of society in general, but also of Catholics themselves. During the conference, it was reiterated how over the years, childless sexuality has been accepted. On this aspect in particular, Cardinal Ladaria explained how life itself, from a gift, has been reduced to a product. For these reasons, the Vatican prefect continued, the encyclical remains prophetic even today in order to counter real anti-humanisms. The Congress sought to address all those who want to rediscover the prophetic call in favor of the dignity of human love and life, confronting the difficulties of the contemporary world with the testimonies of couples and doctors. The Congress was an opportunity to discover the strength of Humanae Vitae as a landmark text. Under the motto, Choose Life, several thousand people demonstrated in Rome on May the 20th at the National Demonstration for Life. Despite the rain, many demonstrators gathered at Piazza della Repubblica and walked almost 1.5 miles to the square in front of the Lateran Basilica.
I'm here to march for life because I know life is very important and to counteract the culture of death in our world.
We participate in the March for Life to witness that life is important from the first moment in which life is conceived, in which the child in the fetus is conceived, until its death. This is important to reiterate, because today, unfortunately, we are in a society that does not allow us to express this. Very often in Italy, for example, abortion is seen as the only option. So we want to make people, women, understand that there are more options.
It used to be called the March for Life, but the name was changed last year to Demonstration for Life.
We need to stand up, we need to show up, and we need to pray and make sacrifices for the conversion of hearts, you know, not only in our own countries, but also here in Italy and in Europe, so that everything will change, you know. So it's one of the greatest injustices that we're, and it's all around us, and a lot of people just don't realize They need to do something about it. We have to help to work those women who are in crisis pregnancy. And they're all around us.
The rally was attended not only by people from all over Italy, but also from other countries, In addition to the personal testimonies, the pro-life demonstrators also have concrete demands for the politicians.
Politici pro-life, non pro-morte.
Pro-life politicians know perfectly that there is a life being killed and what they have to change, right? That the conscience is heavy. They have to have the courage, because there are politicians who defend life, but sometimes they lack courage for the decision to unite and say yes to life and not to abortion.
Sì alla vita e non all'aborto.
Hello, and welcome to this week's Vaticano Updates, the most important news from Pope Francis and the Vatican. An unidentified man is in custody after driving a car at high speed through a gate at the Vatican. Now, a guard stationed at the entrance fired his weapon in the direction of the vehicle's front tires, hitting the left front fender, but the vehicle proceeded onto the Vatican grounds until the driver got out at the San Damaso courtyard, which is the main courtyard of the Apostolic Palace. Now, the man, aged about 40, was immediately subjected to a visit by the doctors of the Directorate of Health and Hygiene of the Vatican City State. Now, they found a serious state of psychophysical alteration, the Vatican statement said. Now, in a letter marking the G7 summit in Hiroshima, Pope Francis asserted that the mere possession of nuclear weapons creates a climate of fear and suspicion and offers only an illusion of peace. Now, in his letter, the pontiff underlined that global security needs to be integral, capable of embracing issues including access to food and water, respect for the environment, healthcare, energy sources, and the equitable distribution of the world's goods. Now, Pope Francis offered his condolences after at least 14 people died in devastating floods in northeastern Italy. Now, the Pope sent a condolence telegram to Cardinal Matteo Maria Zuppi, the Archbishop of Bologna, after intense rainfall across the Italian region of Emilia-Romagna caused severe flooding and landslides. Now, thousands have been evacuated from the worst hit areas. Rescue workers used helicopters and dinghies to help people escape from flooded buildings. Now, the Holy Father approved the beatification of a young Italian priest who was martyred by Nazis during World War II. Now, Father Giuseppe Beotti was shot by the Germans after refusing to leave his parish despite threats to his life. Now, Pope Francis also gave his approval for the causes of 8 servants of God to proceed on the path to beatification. Now, this included 16-year-old Lorena D'Alessandra, who died from a metastasized lung tumor in Rome in 1981. Now, the Vatican announced that Pope Francis visit the Shrine of Our Lady of Fatima, Portugal, next August. Now, Pope Francis is set to participate in World Youth Day from August 2nd to the 6th and is scheduled to visit Fatima on August 5th. Now, the Lisbon trip will mark the 86-year-old Pope's 4th World Youth Day after taking part in the international Catholic gatherings in Panama, Poland, and Brazil. Thank you for watching this week's Vaticano Updates. My name is Benjamin Crockett for EWTN Vaticano.
In a few moments, we'll be back with more on Vaticano.
So our congregation is a congregation that's dedicated to the mystery of the Immaculate Conception. This is God's saving design for all of us. He saved Mary in an extraordinary way through that Immaculate Conception. He saves us through the sacraments. So God wants that gift of salvation to be for everyone. And that's what our founder had in his heart, that desire of God to save everyone.
Most Blessed Virgin Mary was, from the first moment of her conception, by a singular grace and privilege of Almighty God, and by virtue of the merits of Jesus Christ, Savior of the human race, preserved immune from all stain of original sin. Paragraph 491 of the Catechism of the Catholic Church. Throughout the centuries, the Church has become ever more aware that Mary, full of grace through God, was redeemed from the moment of her conception. That's what the dogma of the Immaculate Conception confesses, as Pope Pius IX proclaimed in 1854. The Congregation of Marian Fathers of the Immaculate Conception of the Most Blessed Virgin Mary is a fraternal community of consecrated life that has as its primary purpose the proclamation of devotion to the Immaculate Conception of the Blessed Virgin Mary. They're currently celebrating the 350-year jubilee anniversary of their founding.
Well, we were founded 350 years ago in Poland. Our founder was St. Stanisław Papczynski. He had belonged to the Pierist Fathers, and they had taught poor children. But he felt an impression in his heart from the Holy Spirit to found a community dedicated to the Immaculate Conception. He was a military chaplain. He was a great preacher. He used to write things. But he felt that God was calling this mystery of the Immaculate Conception so that it would be become more well known in the world. It wasn't even a dogma at that time. This was 200 years before the dogma.
The Marian Fathers are primarily known for their devotion to Mary Immaculate, their active service to the church, and their dedication to praying for the poor souls.
Well, we pray for the souls in every Mass. We pray in a special way during the month of November when we visit cemeteries and we pray for the dead. We have the All Saints Day and All Souls Day. But it's really something to remember all the time, because there are people dying every day unprepared to meet the Lord. The best way to prepare is a life lived well with the sacraments, with Mass, with going to confession and things like that. And so that's something that needs to be preached, the preparation for death. And then we have to be with people who are dying so that they can receive the sacraments before they die.
On February the 17th, 2023, in the Consistory Hall, Pope Francis granted a special audience to the participants of the General Chapter of the Congregation of Marian Fathers and the House of Rome.
When we had the meeting with the Holy Father in February, he was talking about all the soldiers who were dying unprepared with all the wars that are going on right now.
The spirit of assisting souls was dear to the heart of St. Stanisław. His conviction was to beg God earnestly for the release of souls who find themselves in expiatory flames, or to come to their help by pious alms, as well as various other means, is to exercise the highest charity.
So praying for the souls, making sacrifices for the souls who have died and need our prayers, because the church is, the belief is that they can pray for us, but they can't pray for themselves. They need our prayers, they need our intercession. And that's why the souls ask for our prayers. So let's remember all our loved ones who have gone before us, our parents, our grandparents, our great-grandparents, that they would be with the Lord, and that we would all someday be reunited together in heaven, which is God's plan.
Today, the Marian congregation has over 500 priests and brothers who labor in 19 countries, including the United States, Argentina, Belarus, Brazil, Cameroon, Germany, India, Kazakhstan, the Philippines, Poland, Rwanda, Sri Lanka, and Ukraine. Father Wojciech Jasiński, Marian Father from Poland, sees the mission of the congregation as more relevant than ever.
Even for people who don't see any sense in their lives, we could say, look, God loves you, and God wanted you, that your life has a deep sense, that you can always see that there is someone who always loves you, which is God. So it is not only about theology, about the dogma, and how the dogma was described, but it is a very positive sense to see that my life is precious and I have something to do, and I have received gifts from God to use them now and enjoy the eternity, the to be in the presence of God for eternity.
So, by the way, Benjamin, I printed out the essay. I gave it to my professor of medieval philosophy. And I said, what grade would you give this text? And he says, B minus.
Really?
ChatGPT got a B minus from my professor of medieval philosophy. So, and then I told him, I said, this was generated by an AI. No, an AI could never do something like this. And I said, try it. And he did. And he's scared.
Rapid progress in artificial intelligence is generating fear as well as excitement. These questions were asked in an open letter from the NGO Future of Life Institute. It called for a 6-month pause in the creation of the most advanced forms of artificial intelligence and was signed by tech luminaries, including Elon Musk. It's the most prominent example yet of how rapid progress in AI has sparked anxiety about the potential dangers of the technology. The latest innovation in the artificial intelligence space is ChatGPT. It's exhibiting unprecedented capabilities, from crafting essays and fiction to designing websites and writing code.
I think that the large platforms are developing these technologies at a increasingly fast rate. The most famous and the best program out there now is ChatGPT, which is the artificial intelligence project of OpenAI. However, there are other programs coming out within a few months, and I've been told when I was in San Francisco 2 months ago that these programs are going to make ChatGPT look like primitive software.
Language is the operating system of human culture. It's our source code. From language emerges myth and law, art and science, friendships and nations. AI's new mastery of language means it can now hack and manipulate the operating system of civilization. What would it mean for humans to live in a world where a large percentage of stories, images, laws, policies, and tools are shaped by non-human intelligence?
What gives you hope, but at the same time, what are you genuinely preoccupied?
The problem is about control. How much control do we have over these programs, basically? And in GPT, the G stands for generative. So what's taking place is that these artificial intelligence are learning, if we want to use that word, and they're growing and they're expanding on their own in a way that we don't even know how to map out. So even the engineers aren't sure how GPT is solving some of the problems that they give it.
The degree of existential risk posed by AI has been hotly debated.
Should we be afraid of this? And I think the answer is yes and no. The potential misuse of this technology is a real reason for us to be concerned.
This powerful technology poses new risks, but also offers extraordinary opportunities. Balancing the two means treading carefully.
It's really not a question of good and evil. It's a question of how can we support human beings. So like you said, Pope Francis has mentioned also, place the human being at the center of the technology. And so what people look at the Vatican, the developers are looking at the Vatican for a moral guide, a kind of moral authority. The Pope is probably the number one moral authority in the world.
We'll be back after a short break with more on Vaticano. How does the Church accompany those in crisis and help them to build a life project? Up next on Vaticano, the first of a four-part series following the missionary activity of the Center, a family of families, in Quito, Ecuador. One of their key benefactors is the Papal Foundation, the only United States-based support charity that exclusively fulfills the requests of the Holy Father. Staff at the Center share the experience of working with the vulnerable through letters to Pope Francis.
Ecuador es un país pequeño, muy diverso. Pero aquí ha habido no una debida atención hacia la gente. Hay mucha gente pobre y hay poca gente rica.
Nos aquejan como país, que nos aquejan como sociedad, y en ese aspecto también estamos en contra del alto.
Y esto genera un ambiente de insatisfacción, que la gente no tiene acceso a los derechos que se necesita. Por eso hay manifestaciones de protestas que no son buenas para el país, y por eso existe inseguridad, porque no tienen trabajo y no tienen comida para llevar a sus casas, y eso hace que haya inseguridad acá en el país.
Centro Una Familia de Familias, buenos días. ¿Cómo podemos ayudarle?
Papa Francisco, mi corazón se llena de alegría y emoción al saber que puedo dirigirme a usted a través de esta carta. Mi nombre es Johnny Espinosa y trabajo en un centro de promoción social jesuita, el Centro Una Familia de Familias, acá en Quito, Ecuador. Gracias a Dios por permitirme ser un instrumento y ponerme al servicio de población en situación de vulnerabilidad.
Papal Foundation is the only organization or charity that we know of that is specifically dedicated to what the Pope's needs are. And it's not really the Pope's needs, it's needs around the world.
The ones that touch my heart are the ones that work with the children, and we have visited some, and to see the dedication in which they run these projects and make basically every penny count just really spoke to me when we visited them.
Nuestro objetivo es brindar herramientas para que las familias, sus niños, puedan empoderarse, es decir, que ellos realmente crean que sí pueden hacer algo por sus vidas y que puedan desarrollar un proyecto de vida.
It really speaks to the subsidiarity part of our church. You know, in solidarity, we look to fund those projects that need to further the work of the church.
And these are organizations that are around the world that otherwise wouldn't get the attention. They're in the furthest, farthest places doing remarkable deeds, but they don't get the notoriety.
Next week on Vaticano, we continue our stories from Quito, Ecuador, where we meet Herman Ruales at the center's food bank and witness the first steps in building the family's foundation for success.